me continue again with the earlier class that we have done. What we did, we started with DC actuators. What was there? We saw principle of operation of a DC motor, basic components that are there. You saw armature, you saw stator, you saw commutators which are there. We also saw the inside of a DC motor. By disassembling a CAD model, we saw how it is internally constructed, how basically it works. We have seen that. Okay, so now that we know the construction of the DC motor, okay, how, what are the formulas which hold true for that, how current and torque is related, and also how speed and torque is related through data sheet that we have discussed earlier in the last class. Okay, so mostly we know the theoretical aspect of this. Now we'll discuss mostly upon today's class, we'll discuss mostly on the drivers for it. What are drivers? Drivers are electrical hardware that basically controls the current, that controls the voltage or maybe effective voltage, that basically does all sorts of controls. So what are parameters that is there to control? We discussed in last class, yes, using the current, armature current, we can control the torque that the motor can deliver, right? And also, you can control the speed of a DC motor by controlling the effective voltage that comes to the DC motor armature. Got it? So, two things are there. You can control voltage, you can control speed, or you can control torque. And you can control direction by changing the polarity of a DC motor. That is quite straightforward. So if you can control the speed, you can control the direction, that means you can go negative maximum to zero to positive maximum. You can be anywhere in between. So, and that also can be changed dynamically. So you can have a trajectory of velocity, rather you can control the acceleration of the angular acceleration of the shaft also. Got it? You can control the torque either, okay, either way you can do it. So these are few things that we want to control. So let us see what all hardware does goes into building such drivers. Okay, it is basically electrical, need not to worry about, because even if you are from mechanical, these are mostly physics, not engineering also. Okay, let me just discuss some of important type of DC motor apart from brushed DC motor, which are having permanent magnet that you saw here. You have what? You have permanent magnet sitting here. You have permanent magnet sitting here. So instead of having permanent magnet in these two, you can have electromagnets which are here. Why that is important? Permanent magnet, they don't lose over period of time. What happens, permanent magnet motor, over the period of time it loses its strength, or sometimes they are not suited for huge motors that are there in industry. Okay, so what type, additional types which are there, we'll discuss now. So if at all you have a DC motor and you have armature that takes in current through the brushes, the black ones which are shown are symbolic to brushes which are here, and the input current also flows through the field coils. F is for field coils. So what this will do, this will create electromagnets from the sides, okay, so that you get a lines of force, magnetic field, and your armature runs in between. Okay, so this field coils also draw some sort of current from the incoming power, okay, DC current. Okay, so that is distributed twice. Once it goes to the armature, it also goes to this. So it can be connected in different ways. The first one in the figure A, it shows field coil is connected parallel to the armature coil, parallel to this. So this type of winding is known as a shunt winding. The armature winding and the field winding are connected in parallel. Speed controllability is good as back EMF is proportional to the voltage at steady state. Back EMF that it generates is proportional to the applied voltage. So this type of shunt motor is very, very common, okay, because you want to control the speed most of the time. So that is why it is common. Another one is a armature and field coils. They are in series. They are in series. Armature winding and field winding are connected in series. Large current flows through the both the windings, because starting torque while the motor is at rest, as soon as you put in the electricity, what will happen? It will try to engage 100% of current to generate the torque. So that is the reason why it has a huge torque. It has a huge starting torque. Okay, this is not there in case of a shunt DC motor, whereas in series you get a huge starting torque. Okay, because the current also flows through the field, so field is also more when you have starting. Whereas in this case, you see field always draws the same amount of current. Okay, whereas this load dependent is the armature current. Okay, in this case, load, if higher is the load, higher is the field also, and that is why it sees a greater amount of torque. So although the characteristics is little different, but yes, this also does the job. And then another one could be a hybrid approach, where you have a compounded series and parallel approach. You get the characteristics of both of them. In the series wound motor, you get to see a large current that flows at the starting. That is why it has a huge starting torque. Whereas in shunt motor, it is almost for a uniformly loaded motor. Like a conveyor belt, it runs throughout the day at the same speed. So this is more suited in that case. Okay. So anyway, but all of these, they don't have permanent magnet as a stator over there. So this is not very common in the industry. Yes, it is common in the automation thing, like a conveyor belt, the motors which are normally big and meant to run throughout the day. So that is the reason I have discussed this. But this, these are not the motors that you will find in day-to-day robotics area. Okay, so let us, before starting the drivers for a DC motor, let us see a very small thing which is known as a transistor switching. A bit of electronics is there, but not more than a first year engineering over here. So hopefully you remember this curve if at all you have gone through basic electronics. Which book did you follow? Milman Halkias or something like that. So anyway, so what it says, this is a transistor. This is a symbol of a transistor. Let us say this is the transistor. So what it does, you apply a voltage from the top. Okay, you apply a voltage VCC from here, and you also apply a voltage to the base of a transistor. Base of a transistor. Okay, you have a collector voltage, you have a base voltage, both the places you apply voltage, and you have an emitter that is grounded. That emitter is grounded over here. So what this circuit can do, you can imagine, to be very, very short, as soon as you apply V in at the base, this opens up this transistor gate. Let us say it is in the gate zone. It is in the gate zone. So what will happen? The current from here will be grounded totally. Okay. So what you will see as an output? What you will see as an output? When you apply V in at the base, VO will be zero, because whole of the current goes to the ground. Whole of the current, it goes to the ground. So what potential that you see here is exactly the potential which is here. So that is what it is, zero. So if you put a voltage here, it goes to ground. If you put a zero over here, zero, true, or 0 volt, all are same. In TTL level, 5 volt, high, or true is all the same. So, 0 is for false, 0 is for false or grounded or 0 volt, everything is same. So, normally what we say it is high or low. okay, because it is digital in nature now. So that is why we will talk about high or low. So because this is the way you can handle this output voltage. Now, because this is a transistor, it can carry a limited amount of current through this circuit. So what happens? You cannot connect this VO output voltage directly to a load. If at all you connect a high voltage over here, this can cause a huge amount of current flowing through the transistor when it is in a low mode, right? So that can damage this. That can damage this transistor. Current has to flow. Either it will go through the load which is connected next to it from VO, or it will flow through the transistor. When it flows through the transistor, it can damage the transistor. So that is why if at all it is just the LED, a small load or a very very small bulb or maybe a small motor also, yes, you can drive it directly just by controlling the input from the base. You can control the output and you can drive a small amount of load. Got it? But if at all it is huge load, what you do, you connect this small VO to a relay input. So what this will do, this input voltage will in turn trigger a relay. Relay can be connected to a huge load. Got it? So that is the way you can connect a huge motor to this type of transistor. In that case, these are known as pilot switches. Pilot switches. Got it? So this pilot switch can be operated from 0 to 5 volt, sometimes 0 to 3 volt or 1.2 volt also, depending on type of transistor which is here. 5 volt is for TTL level transistor logic, or DTL, diode transistor logic system. Or if it is a MOSFET, it can be 0 to 3.3 volt, which is a standard in this type of thing. It can go as low as pico power device, which is 1.2 volt driven. That is with a lithium ion cell that are your watch, your smart watch, your sometimes small devices which run through that particular voltage. Okay, so that is 1.2 volt, and it can go even less. Okay, so that depends on transistor to transistor. One of the very popular one is BC548, BC547. These type of transistor switches are quite common. But yes, MOSFETs, metal oxide silicon field effect transistor, MOSFET switches are very fast. These switches, the transistor based switches, cannot do switching operation at a very high frequency. Okay, so in that case, where you have to switch on and off at a very high frequency, in that case what you will do, you will change this type of transistor to MOSFET transistor, and that can do high speed switching. Like for example, IRF 540 can do fast switching. This is one example. There are many such IRF transistors which are in place. So this circuit is equivalent to this one. You close this, what will happen? The potential over here will go to this and output becomes zero. If you open this switch, what will happen? This VCC appears at VO. Got it? So it is effectively a NOT gate. Is it not? This is effectively a NOT gate. So high over here makes zero over here, low over here. If this is low, this is high, this is high, this is low. So high to low conversion is there. So this is effectively a NOT gate also. So you can either put it this way, or you can connect the load directly over here if it is a small load. So high to high, low to low can also be transferred. You got it? That means you don't use the voltage which is appearing here. Rather, you can connect your load somewhere over here. I'll show you. You can connect load at this location. You disconnect this. So what can happen? In this case, if you make this high, so whole of this current will flow like this and it goes to ground. In this case, high creates high to this. Got it? Very simple. And reverse can happen. If you make this low, low can happen. But the configuration which is shown here is what? This is for high to high, no, high to low and low to high, that is in NOT gate configuration. So this type of things are very, very common. Okay, so now going to next, now we'll try and make different type of drivers. Okay, different type of drivers using this. So one of the very common way to drive a DC motor is known as a H bridge. What exactly is a H bridge? It looks like H, first of all. As the name says, it looks like H. You see, it has three arms. S1, S2 forms one vertical. S3, S4 forms another vertical. And horizontally, it is connected using a motor, which is M, that is along the horizontal. So, it makes a H. Now, let us understand how it works. Okay. And let me do one thing. This is the input voltage. This is input voltage. So this may be plus, this is grounded, or you can show it like this. This is grounded. So what happens if you close this one? If you close this one and this one, what will happen? Current will flow like this. I assume this is always closed. So current goes like this and finally to this. Okay. So from here your current will come and current flows like this through the motor. In this case, let us say this rotates in counterclockwise manner. Got it? How you can reverse the direction? Now that I have switched this one and this one on, I see current flowing like this through the motor. Got it? So in this case, motor has run in a particular direction. Got it? Now let me wipe it off and see what happens if I do otherwise. Okay. Now let me switch this one on and this one on. Got it? These two are on. In this case, how the current will flow? In this time, if this is plus, current will go like this, it will follow this path, it goes like this and finally comes back. Is it not? In this case, current comes like this. It is not like this. Got it? It is not like this, it is like this. So, current flows in reverse direction. In this case, motor will run in opposite direction. Got it? So, just by switching different switches, got it? You can change the direction of this DC motor which is connected to this. Got it? So, this is how it can reverse the polarity across this motor just by creating the switches in different modes. Okay? Switching the switches in different modes. Now, why this SNSEN is there? What this fellow is doing here? SEN, enable thing. What this is doing here? Yes, this is called enabling switch. This is called enabling seat. If this switch is off, irrespective of the positions of S1, S2, S3, S4, motor is off. If this is on, motor is on. This is enabling switch. Why this is important? There is a way to make this motor run in a specific way. What you see here now is basically a PWM signal. What is PWM? It is nothing but a square wave signal. A part of a time signal remains high and it goes low for remaining period. One complete cycle, it will be on for a while, it will be off for a while. Got it? So, what effectively this is doing? If you do, let us say you have a motor, okay, maybe your ceiling fan. What you can do? You can regulate the speed by just putting a resistance at this location. If you put a resistance, it will restrict the current flowing through either direction, both the direction, and it can regulate the speed of this motor. But you have too much of losses over here due to current flowing through that resistance. What type of loss is that called? It is known as I square R loss. That is, heat energy is dissipated from here and you see a lot of loss. Okay, I don't want to do that. I don't want to restrict the flow of current. Rather, I will switch on and off at a very high frequency that this motor doesn't come to know that, yes, I have been switched on and off. Got it? Because of its inertia, it keeps on rotating. Only thing what is happening is the effective power that goes into this motor is reduced. Effective power, that means you can reduce the speed of this motor just by making this switch on and off at a high frequency. So effectively, it is transmitting less power to this motor, and that way also it can control the speed. That is what is known as pulse width modulation, PWM. That is nothing but a square wave signal. Duty cycle of a square wave signal is given by high time by total time of the pulse. So if the duty cycle is 100%, that means it is never off. That means 100% of power will flow through this motor and motor will run at a maximum speed. And if it is 0% duty cycle, it is never on. So it can be 50% duty cycle means 50% of the time it is high, 50% of the time it is low at a very high frequency. Okay, so it will see a 50% of power getting transmitted to the motor and it runs at almost 50% of the speed. Got it? So this is how speed of a motor can be controlled by controlling the PWM signal that is coming at this location. So this also is a transistor. This also is nothing but a transistor, and that can be switched at a very high frequency so that if at all one of the switch status is there, like S1 and S4 is closed, and you apply a PWM over here, it rotates at this direction. PWM over here will create this direction at a particular speed. If it is 50% PWM and this switch is closed, it rotates at counterclockwise direction. If you change the polarity by changing the switch to this condition, this and this closed, motor will rotate in this time counterclockwise direction at 50% speed. So effectively what this fellow is doing, this switch is doing, this particular one, this effectively changes the speed of the motor, and these switches changes the direction of the motor. So speed and direction both can be controlled. Got it? So that is how speed and direction is controlled. If at all you have to control the torque which is available at this motor, then you will have to sense what current is drawn by the motor. If you can somehow control this current, provided this switch has got some voltage over here, effective voltage, these has some status, you can control this current. This is armature current. This can control the torque. Got it? Because torque is proportional to the armature current. That is how torque is controlled. Got it? So this is how these things are done. So now you know how speed, how torque and speed, direction, acceleration, everything you can now control. So in summary, I'll just do this now. Okay, so if I summarize this is for counterclockwise, this is for clockwise, PWM is like this. I'll circulate this, whatever I have drawn on the board just now, I'll circulate whole of this slide so that you can see this summarized slide and you can understand this. So one there are many drivers which are there available nowadays, which are commercially available, which can do these things in no time. It has inbuilt H-bridge driver. You don't have to switch selectively one by one to S1, S4 or S3, S2. It is inbuilt. You just have some wires which can do this. I'll show you a few now. The right side of this figure shows a cyclone motor driver, a cyclone motor driver. Got it? And what all inputs does it have? I'll show you now. Okay, so this you can see, this is a cyclone motor driver. This is exactly the one which is shown here. Can you see this clearly now? Okay, so how many wires do you see? You see, it has so many small IRF, those IRF, I told you MOSFET switches, okay? So 1, 2, 3, 4, that means one H bridge is sitting here, which consists of four different switches. 1, 2, 3, 4, another 4 switches, that means it has one H bridge system, another H bridge system. Yes, it has two H bridge system, that means it can drive two different motor at a time. It can drive two different motor at a time. These capacitors are basically to filter the current which is flowing through this, so that you get to see. And there are many conditioning circuit which are here. Okay, so selectively you can switch this and this. Okay, so now you see how many input and output it has. Yes, two motors which are to be connected. So one motor, another motor will go here, and you have V plus and V minus. This is input supply. It can be 0 to 30 volt. This board supports 0 to 30 volts. Safe is almost 24 volt over here is quite safe. So it can switch a motor of something around 24 volt easily. And it also says it can drive 10 amp. You see, it is 10 ampere, so it can carry as much as 10 ampere. A transistor cannot carry more than 2 amperes, I think. I don't know. But yes, I feel it is almost 2 ampere most of the time. So this one can switch up to 10 amperes at a very high frequency. Okay. So now these are the output voltage input, that is the driving voltage input. Now see the control inputs. So it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 wires. Five wires. And what it says, if you look at closely, I don't know if you can read it, I can read it very well from here. Okay, so effectively it says ground, PWM1, PWM2, DIR1 and DIR2. That means two enabling switches are there, two enabling things. That means those two are to control the speed. One of them is for direction clockwise of one motor, if it is high clockwise, if it is low anti-clockwise. This is for second motor. The last one is for second motor. If it is high, it is clockwise, if it is low, counterclockwise. So, and all these inputs are of 5 volt signal. So, effectively 5 volt signal is controlling this 24 to 30 volt signal, which is as output through this H bridges. So this is our standard cyclone motor driver. There are many similar one with similar input you will see. So input side, ground, which is common, that is for the reference bolt, direction for both the motor, speed for both the motor. Speed means you have to put PWM signal, high low, it's a PWM signal of 0 to 100% duty cycle of 5 volt, okay, that is expected out here. This controls the speed, this controls the direction. There is no torque control system in this type of drivers, okay. So let me show you some more drivers which I have with me now. One very popular one, I think this is a saber tooth one, I think, okay. This also has similar thing. This also has two motor connectors over here, five different wires over here, and this doesn't have any separate 5 volt for this. Control signal is always expected to be of 0 to 5 volt. Okay, so this is a it has four sorry this has got 1, 2, 3, and 4 four different switches. That means it has just one H bridge. So one must be for voltage input of the motor driving, and another one for motor output, motor connection. These are for input control signals. Okay, again this doesn't have a, this also doesn't have signals for, just a sec, let me see if I have. One very standard one is L298 driver, L298 chip. This is a unique chip, very very popular in hobby electronics and toy motors and robotics thing, those who do obstacle avoidance and those things. It is known as L298 driver. So this is a standard circuit that comes with similar input, 5 input voltage input, 2 motors. This also can drive 2 motors. This also can drive 2 motors. So L298 type, this is very very common. L298 has got high current rating, almost up to 2 ampere of current and 12 volt. It can run very well. Okay, so it shows it is L298. There are other chips like L293, which is for 1 ampere and 2 motors can be driven. Okay, so I think these are some of the drivers which are very very common. Okay, but you can choose depending on the amount of current that you need. 10 amp for Cytron, 2 amp L298, less than that I think L293 or a standard Sabertooth driver they can do. Depending on current rating you can choose different drivers. None of them they had current control. None of them they had current control. Because we hardly need it until unless we are happy with just controlling the speed of the motor and direction. And we can do most of the things. That is what is mostly required in hobby electronics and mostly entertainment based robotics. But yes, for serious robotics you have to have that knowledge as well. So we'll cover that also now, a bit of that, not exactly 100% of that. So what you see here, this is a permanent magnet DC motor, quite commonly Maxent DC motor. These are very very precise motor, as we have done some exercise earlier also. Got it? So coreless DC motors are there. If you have seen my video earlier, first video on DC motors, it has coreless. Why? Because in order to reduce the inertia, if you want to stop it then and there as when you have commanded. So this type of motor is very helpful. This is coreless motor. So PMDC motor, referred to as torque motor, can provide very high torque. It has no field coils because they have permanent magnet. Magnet should have high flux density. These are some of the properties of this type of motor. They don't have field coils. Advantage of this is basically they have high excitation power supply. Okay, field coils are not there. So excitation power supply for the field coils are not there. Right? You don't need to supply separate current to field coils. Right? You can just be happy with the commutator current that you supply. Reliability is improved because there is no field coil, so that coil cannot go bad, it cannot burn at overload. Okay, so no power loss from the field coils because it doesn't have field coils, so there is no I square loss that is happening there. Any field coil, even if it is not purely inductive in nature, it is resistive also, because they are coils, they are thin coils, it has some resistance, they get heated. Disadvantage basically of this type of motor is because of brush and the commutator, they go bad very soon. If it is continuously run motor, it is prone to be very much damaged very soon. Okay, so that is what is PMDC motor. How does it look like? There are many motors that I have with me in my hand today. One of the popular one is this small one. The last day I showed you section of this. Hobby electronics people, they might have used this one. Is it not? So can you name the components which are here? It has two wires, you see, black wire, red wire. And back portion, this portion is basically the motor. Black one is gearbox. It is the gearbox. so that you, because this motor runs at a very high RPM, 3000 to 6000 RPM, speed is to be reduced in order to make a valuable output. Got it? That speed has to be reduced because your, let us say you have a wheeled rotor, it cannot afford to have 3000 RPM of its wheel. Engine side it is fine, but wheel RPM should not be more than 200 to 500 RPM. Got it? So that is the reason. So if speed is reduced, so torque is increased because power input through these wires is constant. Volt into current, that is the power input to this motor. If power input is constant, output is torque into speed. Torque into speed. So if you increase the speed, torque is reduced. And vice versa, right? So this, what type of gearbox is this? Anyone? This has a epicyclic gearbox, epicyclic gear train. Why, you know? Because input shaft and output, just by looking at the motor, you can say, yes, this is input side, this is output side, both are collinear, a single line mein, it is lying. So it is epicyclic gearbox inside. Otherwise, you can have a gearbox which looks like this. You have shaft from input shaft here and output shaft is little off. Both the axes are parallel, aligned, but yes, they are collocated. Little distance is there in between. Okay. So, this is a standard gearbox. It is not epicyclic. This is called gear train. So this is also, this can also be attached to different types of motor. So that also is very, very common. So gearbox is part and parcel of any robotics thing because you cannot have a motor which runs at a very high RPM. Got it? So that is the reason. Firstly, and then it should be controllable. If it runs at a very high RPM, it tends to overshoot where you want to stop. Is it not? Most of the time in industrial robotics, you deal with position control. You deal with position control. You have to stop quite often. Got it? So that is why it should run very. Any day-to-day life like lift also is meant not to run all the time. You have to stop and stop precisely. It should not overshoot and come back. So in order to make it controllable, it has to be there. In order to elevate the torque, then also gearbox is there. So that is why gearboxes are very, very important. Through transmission it is used. Okay, coming to next, these are comparison of some commercially available drivers which are there. You see, most of them have closed loop for, see, it has position and velocity. It can control both. It can just do position. So I have tabulated them well. What is braking? Braking is one very interesting thing. I'll come back to the earlier slide now before I can discuss braking. What type of braking is this? Current control, there are a few motor drivers which does current control also. There are current control boards also, but yes, that is only for safety. Not, you cannot control the current. If at all it overshoots a certain value, your motor should be tripped because that overcurrent can burn your motor. So that is why it is only for safety. So most of these drivers, you see, current control is not there. Even if it is there, it is not accessible. That means you are not controlling the current. Some way the motor manufacturers are able to access that, and they are able to do control to precisely locate the position, okay, precisely reach to a position. Okay, you have no control over the proportional integral or derivative gain. We'll talk about the controls, we'll come to this again. So that is there, and number of channels, it can be one channel, it can be two channel. Citron motor driver I showed you, it has a two independent touch bridge, so it is two channel thing. So there are four channel also which are available. Normally most of the wheeled robot, they are two channels, so that is why two channel is very, very popular. So now let me talk about braking. So how braking can be done? Let us come back to this figure once again. Okay. Then what a DC motor is, basically, if you have seen your toy closely, if you are running it, it is fine. Okay, the battery is energizing your wheel and your motor is moving forward that particular vehicle, a small toy. But at times you must have noticed, if you drag that robot on the floor by your hand, your wheel rotate, and if at all there is any light or LED, it glows up. Why? Because that motor generates electricity. That can generate electricity. It is a DC motor. Magnet rotates the coil. If you rotate the coil yourself, that coil will see some sort of current getting induced into it. Why? Because a moving conductor inside a magnetic field will have potential difference that will come. So that is the reason. So it becomes a generator. Okay. In that case, what will, let us say your robot is already running, you want to apply a brake, something that you can do now. If you connect this and this, S2 and S4, this motor was moving, it was creating a positive and negative over here. What has happened? Basically, it creates a short circuit. Whatever is generated here, what this has done? It has created a loop current. So, it has short circuited, and this will create a back thrust to this, reverse torque to this, and motor tends to stop. Got it? So, this type of braking is known as a regenerative braking. As long as motor is running, if you short circuit the output, it will stop. It will tend to stop, but it can never go to zero. Why? As soon as it has stopped, it is no longer generating any electricity. And you cannot short circuit it anymore, and it generates no torque at all. So that is the reason. It cannot bring it to the static rest, but yes, it can do reduce the speed. So this type of braking is called regenerative braking, where you have control over these two transistors as well. Got it? And that is braking. Where it is used? It is used in locomotives, railway engine. If it is running, it doesn't apply the brake shoe while it is running at 120 kilometers per hour. Okay, all the shoes will wear off in no time. What it does a similar thing. It simply short circuits, it disengages from the top, okay, and it engages the brake, okay, this short circuit with a huge resistance with a fan on top, okay. So, it dissipates all the generated electricity and it creates a back thrust and wheel comes to almost stop condition. When it slows down sufficiently, they apply physical brakes, that is brake shoes, vacuum brakes basically. So, it is very, very common even in the locomotive, okay. It never goes off, okay. So, most of you have seen it, train comes to stop at a very longer time, okay. It takes quite a huge amount of time to stop. This is the reason. Got it? So, okay, looking at inside, that was basically electric AC motor, but that also is common. So what all things you see here is, this is what is braking, which is meant here. So, position control, velocity control, braking is there, current control is there. Position cannot be controlled unless you have a feedback. Okay, so the feedback is also necessary. So, although this type of driver supports position control, motor as a whole, motor doesn't have a feedback. If you start it, it will run in one direction. If you stop it, it will stop by regenerative braking. If you reverse the polarity, it can go to other direction. It cannot stop at a precise angle. That can only be achieved by a feedback. So, motor not only has attachment like gearbox, it also has an attachment called encoders, joint angle sensors. We'll talk about that in more detail while we talk in sensor, while we'll be discussing sensor. Got it? I think yes, sensors we'll discuss that. So, that's all for today, I think. So, I'll stop here. That's all for today. Thank you.